Today. It's wonderful to have this turnout. USB React Final Findings Conference. Sexual violence, not a new issue, clearly, but I think seemingly some new public recognition of the issue, some new determination to bring perpetrators to justice and to properly to support survivors. So that's quite an exciting moment to be reporting from this project. This is a 2 million euro project co-funded by the European Union. Each of the partner universities have also contributed 20%, so they get a nod too. Because we're such a big project team, it's very exciting for us to come together today. This is actually only the fourth time we've met as a whole team. So the conversations we're having with each other are live, real, genuine conversations about the work people have been doing over the last nearly two years. So it's 3 months to go before the end of a two-year project. I'm grateful to the EU for making today free to attend. Okay, but this is a chance for us at the end of the actions that we've done in this project to discuss what we've done, which is develop and pilot training courses for staff in universities to support, to respond well to students disclosing sexual harassment, sexual violence or sexual abuse, and to try to, the longer title of the project that you'll see, the longer title has got making services sustainable in it. So that's one of the aims. For anybody in the university sector, that's a key challenge, I think. So the teams we have, I'm very excited about this dream team I was able to put together for this. I'm managing the project with Alison Phipps. I'm Pam Aldrin, I'm the principal investigator of the project. And Alison Phipps is a co-investigator. And the project is very much rooted in Alison's research on lad culture and how it, what we might problematically term lad culture, how it thrives in neoliberal contexts that universities have become, and how we might not be surprised when market rationalities are applied to sexuality and dating in a context where it's applied to your lectures, your coffee, your work. Okay. So I was delighted by this team. It's a team that involves now 25 universities. We have 8 partners, 7 of whom are universities, each of whom have developed a training specific for their context and then piloted it in a couple of universities nearby in the region. So the research base is then wider in those contexts. We're really pleased that there's a coordinator for each of those universities and a researcher managed to join us today. This is the structure. We also have associate partners from 2 other countries, from Latvia and Serbia, so I'm delighted to welcome them today from feminist organisations that do campaigns and training there. The action teams from Italy, UNITO, from Greece, Pantheon, from Spain, URV, from Tarragona, and UPV from the Basque Country. And then 3 UK partners, Sussex, York, and Brunel Universities. So they're the teams you'll hear from. We are at the stage of reporting the actions from each of those partners and the evaluation reports from each of those actions will go up online. So we thought there was no need to repeat, to use the day to have a session from each party, from each team, repeating that. We wanted to avoid that repetition. So we structured the day thematically. So that might mean that you get a taster of how things went in Greece or in the Basque Country, and then have to wait till much later to explore the rest of that context. But we think we'll try that structure, and it might work. You'll be able to download the partner evaluation reports from the website soon. Okay. So, we wanted today to be participative. We thought that by that thematic structure, we could discuss with you our analyses or our tentative analyses or our findings, and really make the most of having the expertise and the experience in the room that you bring. So the delegates on the participation list are a really exciting bunch of women's sector, university policy, trainers from different organisations, HE managers, students' union managers. So really exciting. So the expertise is something that we really want to make use of during the day. So please do share your views, comments, and that's why we've structured, we've only given speakers quite short moments to speak for. Okay, so we also have members of our expert advisory group here. We're pleased with that. And representative of our grants officer from the European Commission. So thank you for travelling to attend. So the seven teams have all developed in their different contexts. We do need to understand those contexts to understand whether their universities had care pathways, whether they were in contexts where there were particular risks or environments. So people will locate themselves, I think, as they explain their experience. And it would be nice if people from the floor did that as well, explained where you're speaking from. I don't think any of us see universities as particularly dangerous places, but I think anywhere no more than others with similar age, club, alcohol demographics, probably. But I think we probably do see them as exciting places where there's the chance to educate, the chance to build a community that is resistant, supportive, and is trying to challenge some of the mainstream cultural baggage that's around. So I think we all came into this project. The team was united around feminist research, feminist activist experience of supporting survivors, a desire to do what was support work within this project, but within a broader context of doing prevention work, doing values-based change. And that's where Alice and I both researched in the past. We looked at how we could do educational interventions in institutions, in educational institutions, HE, in universities in Alison's case, schools in my case, to think about how we could change values around sexualities. So that was the underpinning of it. Delighted then to get onto the team, people associated with the lab culture, people contributing to the lab culture research, Benita Sundaram, Carolyn Jackson, the team's got great expertise within it, so do take the chance to talk to these people about their research as well. Okay, so responsive and preventative. Mostly this morning's panel, we're talking about responsive, how we can, what good practice might be in supporting students who disclose sexual violence. But I think we'll pick up on that much more throughout the day, but in the afternoon sessions that are workshops, a chance to talk about training methodologies and how we might in practice ready staff to respond well to disclosures. So, I couldn't not mention this week's headlines, the parallels being drawn between the feudal dynamics of Hollywood and academia. And I think the point's well made about where there's big status differentials between senior and junior staff, there's an additional culture. So I'm grateful to the 1752 group for putting on the agenda, keeping on the agenda, staff abuse of students. Most of our focus at the start was on abuse among students or with students as survivors of abuse. These are all important to put on the agenda and would all be covered by good support programs. Okay, the national discourse in the UK, we're now having a conversation in the UK about abuse and sex and sexualisation. And I think what's good is that we can see that debate, by the whole range of disclosures and accusations it's drawing on, I think it is showing a recognition of the link between sexism, sexualisation and abuse. So I think those connections are being made quite well. And I think there's an international discussion, there's a particular UK one around Westminster, etc. Westminster, as it's happening to calling it. So that will be part of our discussion today. I can see the Italian team nodding there. Okay, right. We could see, as Alice and I wrote the bid, we could see that the UK context was changing rapidly. and of course the University's UK recommendations for practice that came out a year ago are already requiring, recommending that universities in the UK do training intervention work with students around values, something like the bystander intervention, do work with staff, do evaluate their reporting practices. So many of the things we were about to recommend are already on the table for all universities in the UK to be doing. And there's now a year's worth of good practice really on some of those elements more broadly. Okay, so shared principles. I think the team came together with feminist academics, with activist connections. I think we shared a recognition that we needed to think about gender-based violence in intersectional ways, particularly around race and ethnicity and age, sexuality, all the dimensions that make some people better supported, some people more quickly accused, some people less believable, etc. And we're informed by critical education, critical pedagogies that want to problematise norms, that want to think about how children, young people, before they arrive at university, need to be educated to be critical readers of pornographic imagery and of sexualisation. So I think we're more or less using something like the gender-related violence definition from the previous project. So at least. So three of the partners, the Italian team, the Women and Gender Studies Research Centre at UNITO, Brunel and SEPS, the coordinating body, are all partners who've worked together several times, most notably on the Gap Work project, the resources for which are still all up online. And these are to help practitioners who work with young people tackle gender-related violence in young people's lives. So there are a broader set of resources, but similarly, free to download, the idea is that staff colleagues use them to do education work with each other. Okay. I forgot to mention that the third strand of the management of this project is GGB, so the best project manager you could possibly have. Okay. The other strand that we all draw on, I think, is a deconstructive cultural critique level, as well as wanting to do support work with young women. So that's the prevention and support angles we want to hit. Okay. The tension between universal design in a project like this and making interventions fit for purpose. Of course, the most important thing is that each team makes an intervention that's relevant to their context. And that scuppers the research that you might like to do across them. So it's a messy job to try to think across the projects, but we'll do a little bit of that. Okay, so thank you to the researchers who are no longer part of the project. It is a reflection on the institutions, I think, that all three UK universities lost their researcher to a permanent job and have had to bring in other researchers. So there are some people whose name, Rachel O'Neill, Neil Leptown, and Mary Cobbett-Onyek, aren't listed on here. They've all contributed to the project. Okay, so finally, please look after yourselves today. If you need a break, we have this breakout space here where the lunch will be, and there's a cafe there you can move into. The volunteers are social work students, or social workers who've just qualified at Brunel. You're all your views looking after yourselves, but please do today. I'd like everyone to share your views and please explain where you're coming from. I'm thinking mostly organisationally and geopolitically there. And I'm looking forward to hearing the patterns that we can identify, what people have been able to do in conditions not of their own choosing, what you've managed to do. So thank you.